heard about modernizing libbpf with libbpf. Hi, thanks for coming, everyone. I'm Viktor. I'm Red Hat, and as I know, I'm going to talk about bpftrace from a slightly different perspective, but I'm going to present some interesting stuff that we did in bpftrace over the past year. I'll get a nice overview, but let me just repeat some things on what bpftrace is and what are the charges of the tool. First of all, the definition of bpftrace would be it's a high-level tracing language and tool for Linux, which leverages bpf, which uses bpf technology. And there are a lot of goals, but the main one is that we want to provide users a simple yet powerful language in which they can create tracing programs very fast. Part of it, we also want to create some level of abstraction for users from the underlying bpf, because as many of you probably know, writing bpf programs is not trivial. There's a lot of tooling supporting it, but still writing a very simple bpf program tracing some simple events requires a lot of work. It requires some knowledge of C, etc. With bpftrace, we try to writing them in a very fast manner. An example, for instance, you can see it, simple like one-liner bpftrace script, which traces, which attaches to every VFS in the kernel, and it basically collects the number of times every VFS function is called in the kernel over 1 second in total. And it prints you number of times every VFS function was called during the 1 second interval. We can simply write it with this very, very simple one-liner. bpftrace has many problems. Daniel has mentioned some of those, but another problem that we used to have in past, it got improved, and that's what I'm going to talk about today, that we kind of fell behind the development of bpftrace upstream, both in the kernel and also in the libbpf side, which is very fast these days. So let me just briefly go through how the architecture of bpftrace, what it looks like. So we start with what we call bpf script program. Bpf script is what we call this simple language that we provide to users to write the programs in. And then we compile it into LVM error, which is what Daniel mentioned already. Then we take the LVM error and use Clang or LVM to compile it into bpf bytecode. Basically, we create a bpf alpha. And the next thing we used to do is manually, for each map that we had in the bpf program, we manually called bpf map create to create a map inside the bpf subsystem. We received a file descriptor, and we manually filled the file descriptor into the program. So we basically did a relocation. Really, bpf does as relocation. Similarly, for each program, we manually call bpf load for the program to load it into the kernel, receive the file descriptor, and then we call either libbpf or bcc to attach the program to the event we want to attach it to. Now, many of you are probably aware, and as you can clearly see, there's a lot of stuff that libbpf already can do, and it can do it much better than us. So it would be nice to, modernize our architecture in a way that will allow us to leverage what libbpf can do. So, our limitation is that with the architecture, we cannot use all kinds of modern bpf features that have appeared in bpf over the past 5 years, such as maybe even more. Subprograms. So with this, we cannot do subprograms because subprograms require relocations, which we would have to do manually, which is something you don't want to do because it's kind of a complicated step. We cannot do cover E, so that answers Andrew's question if we do use cover E. No, we don't, because we weren't able to do that because of this legacy architecture. We cannot use global variables. We cannot use token functions in the kernel. We only can call helpers. And so on and so on. And obviously, as I already said, we are duplicating all the functionality with libbpf already. So, what my talk is going to be about is how we did this migration to this new architecture. both most of them be bpftrace side, but some of them were on the libbpf side also. So maybe after a session on how to approach this. So I would like to walk you through this process that we did. I hope that it could be helpful also to other tools which try to create the custom front end for bpf using libbpf as a backend. So not using the front end part of libbpf where you can write programs in C, but you write them in your custom front end, but you want to use libbpf as a backend. Okay, so this is again the legacy architecture. So what I propose here, what we did here is we first create not any bpfl object file, but bpf object file which is compliant with what libbpf expects. And this is a crucial part because then we can basically replace the second 2 points with a single call to bpf, or two calls with two bpf object open and bpf object load, which will let libbpf do a lot of work for us. So the part was creating the bpf object, which is compliant with what libbpf expects. And then, obviously, we still need to call either libbpf or bcc to attach. Libbpf can do a lot of this automatically already, but we are not there yet, so I'm mentioning it. We still use a few attachments via manual calls to either libbpf or bcc. Okay, so let's go. Let's see what kind of properties does a bpf object need to have in order for libbpf to understand it and to do a lot of stuff for you automatically. The best document I've found it. Is this standardization effort, which is already one and something years old. It's just a draft, it's not yet standardized, but it sort of summarizes most of the properties that you need to have, such as programs, BPF programs in your object must be stored in test sections and they are identified by function names. All the subprograms must be stored in the dot text section. Maps are stored in the dot map section and they attached to them so that libbpf can understand them. License needs to be stored, and there's a few more constraints or requirements which I don't list here because they are not that important. Okay, let's go through the individual parts. So for the programs, as I said, each BPF program or a subprogram is represented as a separate function, which is where the first problem occurs. Because what bpf trace is good about, one of the nice features of bpf trace is that you can create one program and attach it to many, many events in the kernel by just specifying wildcards in the attachment points. So you have seen this in the first slide. You can do VFS underscore asterisk, and then it will attach the next function and attach to all the VFS function in the kernel. Now, this can be solved in several ways. I will get back to it later. But it's one of the problems that we encounter with this. Another thing that we found out is that we need to add function info. So we didn't do it in the past. So now we need to add function info for libbpf to understand our programs better, which means that we have to create LLVM debug information and attach it with our LLVM IR, and then let libbpf generate BTF for us and close it in the proper .btf and .btf extension, which is again something that libbpf requires to happen. Luckily, LLVM is very good at doing this, so we just emit the debug info on libbpf level, sorry, on LLVM level, and LLVM will take care of everything else. As for that, that's where it gets more interesting, because libbpf expects maps to be defined as global variables in the map section, so the detection. However, each map needs to have BTF information attached. And for the BTF question, you need to have some mandatory fields. There are some optional ones, but the mandatory ones are you need to specify the type of the map. So, for instance, it's a hash map, it's an array map, whatever, per CPU hash map, etc. You need to specify the maximum number of entries, and you need to specify the type of the key and type of the value. Now, the problem is that BTF is a type of information. So, for specifying type of the key and type of the value. But type, the map, and the maximum number of entries are integers. So you need to find a way to encode an integer type. Now, it's tricky. Libbpf puts it in a very interesting way by representing. as pointers to arrays, integers, where the size of the array becomes the integer that you want to encode. So for instance, I have an example here, maybe the BPF definition of a map. For it, you can see it has four entries at the bottom. And for instance, for the type entry, you can see that the type ID is 1, so it's close to the top. It's a pointer to a type ID 3, which is the interesting part. And type 3 is array, which has one element. It's the last part. Number of elements is 1, which means that encodes integer number 1, which in some enum says that this is a standard hash map. Therefore, the match entries is the same story. However, you can see that the number of elements of the array type is 4096, which means that this map will have 4096 elements. Now, this is something I had to dig from a command in some source code in libbpf. So it took me a while to figure it out why libbpf is so, libbpf is not accepting my map definitions. Eventually, I succeeded, so hopefully, if someone else tries to do this, you know now how to do it. Unfortunately, this is the one part that is missing from the standard I just loaded, so I really had to go through the code. For the key and the value, as I said, it's easy because they are types, so you can represent them with types. The last part was license. License is easy. A license is just stored in a section called license. It's a string, so it's easy to store it. Right. Once we did all this, we could actually use libbpf to do a lot of work for us, which enabled quite a lot of new interesting features. Probably the most interesting one is looping over maps. So now you can, in bpf trace, now you can write a loop which will do something for each map element of a map. To that, we leverage the bpf for each map element helper, which accepts a callback function. And this is the reason why we couldn't do it before, because as I said, we couldn't do sub programs because they need relocations and bpf information. We didn't have that, we now have this. So we can actually grab the callback function and we can actually basically transform the body of the for loop into a callback function internally. This, again, is one of the nice ways how bpf trace abstracts the bpf layer out of the user. The user doesn't have to know that the body of the loop is actually transformed into a callback function. It just looks like a normal code to the user. I personally believe it's a nice thing to do. Another thing is programs, so we can finally split our bpf script programs into multiple subprograms. That is common in pretty much every programming language out there. Currently work in progress by Thomas. It will obviously simplify the code, especially if you have large scripts. You can reuse code, you can simplify it, make it more readable, more maintainable, and so on. It also opens up a way to maybe eventually create something like a bpf trace standard library where we would keep as part of some list or collection of some standard functions which you can use from your bpf trace scripts, which would be a nice thing to do. Related to that, we can not only code, like create internally bpf trace functions, but we can also channel bpf functions. So we can actually written, for instance, in pure BPF, we can link the BPF objects together and then call these functions from inside BPF trace programs, from inside BPF script, which will be very good. An example to use it is there are, for instance, stack walkers, for instance, Python or other languages written in pure BPF, and we can leverage these to actually walk from inside BPF script programs. It's again currently a work in progress by Alistair. Many more which I didn't mention or which I just mentioned here on the slide. For instance, global variables, we already use them internally. Kernel functions, so finally, not only since kernel is not adding any more helpers, but it's only adding kernel functions. We definitely want this feature because we can now use all the nice the functionality that's called that kfunks flow. It's a work in progress by me, so hopefully, we'll get it there soon. We do have, Janelle mentioned, it's something called AOT, ahead of time compile program, so we can compile a BPF trace program and then run it later. and you don't need a LLVM on the target machine anymore, which is a nice thing to do. And for that, we will obviously need coverage to be tweaked for the programs to be, you know, transferable to other kernels, etc. So this, again, this modernization allows us to do this very simply because we will just leverage bpf to do the orbit for relocations. We will just emit the relocations and we'll take care of everything. Okay, I mentioned at the beginning that we ran into a couple of problems, and for some we already proposed solutions, for some we will need to do that. So I would just like to briefly walk you through what are the most important problems here. First of all, is that the current description of the bpf program is sort of incomplete. Standardization effort is there. It's quite a nice document, but it's still missing some parts. Actually, the description of the bpf map format, but there are other things, like, so for instance, it doesn't say which characters are valid, but as probe names, so we have to escape our probe names. We have to replace a lot of characters in order to libbpf actually our probe names. Let's say how global variables, for instance, should be used, in which section they should be placed, etc., etc. So this is more of maybe proposal for the community that this is something to work on, that we should together properly proceed with the standardization, or at least document this properly somewhere, because something that other tools use, and it could be nice to have it documented somewhere. And as a part of it, I have a question which is more of a rhetorical question. The ELK format should be considered an ABI of the bpf, with also a lot of things that come with that, such as if the bpf should not break it in future versions. So it means, for instance, change the name of the section in which maps are expected to be, because that will break the entire bpf trace at least. But other tools which are using, which are generating bpf objects in a way that the bpf understands them. So this is something to consider, I think.
Let's go one by one. So I agree that it would be nice to document, and it seems like you already kind of like reverse engineered all that, so maybe you can contribute to the documentation. I don't think we should standardize this, but like we do have all documentation for the specific stuff, like for example, we actually describe all possible section definitions. But so like how conventions, I guess, should be documented somewhere there, so like if you please contribute. But also, just for you or for someone else, like keep in mind that some of this is sort of based on language assumptions. Right? So when you ask me, like, you were surprised by the identifier restrictions,
I actually figured out that.
Same for, like, where the variables are placed. It's like where this compiler places them.
Many of these depends on the ELK API. But there are some extensions to it, such as like maps or kfunks go into dot something.
Yeah, maps are tricky. And then for the last one, whether it's ABI, yes, it is.
Right, okay.
If you're going to break this, it will be like another major audit.
Again, it could be a part of the document. Okay, another problem I mentioned is the wildcard difference. Again, to repeat, what we want to do is we want to take one program and attach it to many targets. And there are many ways to do this, so let me just briefly go through them. So the most obvious and the simplest solution is using so-called multiprobes, which is something that has been added into the kernel a while ago. Unfortunately, it's only available for certain program types at the moment, for k-probes and u-probes. So as long as people are attaching to these, we obviously leverage multiprobes, so it's great. It would be nice to add them for more program types, especially append trees, which now have to be resolved in a different way. What we currently do is we duplicate them in the ELK object directly. So we basically, when we have one program which we need to attach to many append trees, we basically duplicate the program many times, each one for each entry for which we want to attach it to, which is inefficient, obviously. You can see for an example, I think it's from the example from the first slide, will increase the size. Okay, that was a K-probe on the slide, but if you use app entry there, it would increase the size of the file from 9 kilobytes to some 6 kilobytes, so it's considerable. Sometimes we do have to duplicate, though, because especially when we work with TracePoint or USDT arguments, we have to duplicate. We don't have any other option because either each probe has a different way, must have a different internal code how to access these arguments. Sometimes it should be avoided.
That's not exactly true. Cookies and have one program.
That is correct, yeah. We could leverage cookies. K-function and stuff. Okay. There are a couple of other solutions which I just want to mention here for reference. One of them is something that is used by Retsnu, because Retsnu underscore is something a similar thing to us, and that is the manually cloned. So you just have one instance of the program in the ELF object. You let libbpf resolve all the relocations, everything, then let it load it, be loaded, and then you take the program and manually clone it by using bpf prog load separately for each of the match or each of the attach point you want to do, and then you can just attach this to the different events. Another idea would be to use subprograms, so you basically would close the code of the function into a subprogram, and then it will, which will just fall into this global subprogram, which will again decrease the size of the L object. Fortunately, if I understand correctly, the global subprogram will still be cloned inside the memory in kernel, so it doesn't resolve the problem of being like cloned many times. If you have 1,000 functions or 10,000 functions, it will still be cloned 10,000 in the memory when it's being loaded. Another one which I proposed, but we eventually found out it's too complicated, would be using, but I just give it here for reference, would be using symbol aliasing. So what you can do in an ELF object in general, you can create multiple symbol table entries for the same code by using compiler built-in alias, or in LVM you can use LVM alias. However, libbpf was not really prepared to this, and it required some changes. And it turned out that these changes are even much more complicated than I thought at the beginning they would be. So it's not really, it's quite a, like, it's a complicated change for such a, well, sad thing, let's say. So I'm just giving it for reference. So our current solution is we will try probably to change the manual expansion inside the ELF to manual cloning by bpf prog load, which is what Retsnu does. Maybe we will just need to add a couple of libbpf APIs, but that should be fine. And then we would try to gradually add more multi-probe support for more program types, such as trace points, or BTF-enabled raw trace points, app entry, app exit, etc., etc. Okay, another problem, which hopefully is a simple solution, is that once we do the loading and it fails, it's kind of difficult to find out what actually failed, because BPF object load will return a negative error number, I think, but we don't know what particular. So we don't know if one of the programs failed to load or one of the maps failed to create, and so on. So BPF does have a log where this information is stored, but you would have to parse the log, which we obviously don't want to do. The file descriptors of the maps and the programs, they are either minus one or zero, or some positive numbers, so they are either initialized, which is minus one, or they are initialized with some valid file descriptor. So what I would propose here is simple. I would like if we could cover the error number in the file descriptor, negative error number in the file descriptor of the program or the map which fails to log. So bpftrace has a much easier job identifying and telling the user where is the problem, trying to get the particular program or the particular map which actually fails to load or create. Should be quite an easy fix, hopefully. Okay, that's it for the work that we did. Just a few mentions of what we are still missing, if anyone wants to help, and what we would like to do. So the next one would be already do attach to some of the events via libbpf. However, we still use BCC to attach to many of especially docs which have been in the kernel for a long time, so probes, U probes, trace points, USDTs, etc. We would like to migrate these to libbpf. One of the goals is to actually get rid of the dependency of bpf trace on BCC. So it allows us to drop a big dependency. And eventually, we could even leverage libbpf auto-attachment features. So we, if we place the programs into, if we named the sections properly, libbpf would do the attachment for us, and we wouldn't even have to do any calls. For relocation, another thing, as I said, it would be useful for key, and in theory, it should be pretty straightforward. As I said, we just generate the relocation entries, and we let LVM generate the relocation entries for us, and libbpf do the relocation stuff. Okay, so that's one of the most two important future work parts. And just to conclude, so bpftrace underwent quite a significant modification on how we load bpf programs by uploading a lot of work to libbpf. So this could be a nice inspiration for other projects which come with their own bpf frontend and want to use libbpf as a backend. Hopefully you could maybe use the slides as a reference. A lot of work to do, mainly on bpftrace side, but also there are a couple of patches which could be added to libbpf or bpf in the kernel, and also some documentation work which would help us a lot. If you want to discuss more about bpftrace, there's a BOF session tomorrow at 5 p.m. in one of the BOF rooms, so feel free to come, and if you are missing any features in bpftrace or you are annoyed by some behavior of bpftrace, please come tell us. We will try to fix it. That's it. That's everything from me. Thank you, and I'm happy to take questions.
The pros and cons of standardizing format.
As I said, I consider that a set of conventions, yes, it's kind of ABI for libbpf, but it's like one way to do things with AI format. So it seems like it's not libbpf chose to. Some of the choices are like kind of organically on things. Documenting, I agree, standardizing.
There was this draft standardization, so I thought that it was some sort of agreement with the community that want to standardize this, but yeah, I agree, documenting is.
Standardization started with standardizing ISA and yeah. Something more kind of step in stone. I mean, what do you think about this libbpf?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yeah. So. I mean, it doesn't have to be standardized, it just has to be documented.
One thing you might want to look at is on the added auto-attach, customized auto-attach support. So it might be something that might be useful for the wildcard probe.
It could, yes, but not for F-entry because they do not support, F-entries do not support mass attach it. But for the K-probes and U-probes, yes.
The purpose of the custom callback for attachment is like something like a custom in convention, and that's what the callback is. They have sort of like a full control over which programs that are, so they can comply with it.
Yeah, we can do that, yeah.
I actually had a question about UCT. You mentioned that they can still use UCT to attach UCT. Mm-hmm. So I assume that like when UCT is used to produce libbpf compatible out, because like UCT in libbpf, special thing.
Yeah, we don't. Yeah, we don't follow the specialties of libbpf in terms of handling USDTs. We eventually will if we want to use libbpf to attach them, but not yet. Yeah, we're using. Yeah.
we've been having last Daniel's talk. If we use a single program for like, you know, the multi stuff, I guess that means we couldn't use per CPU maps for the variables if everything is loopable.
Why do we just generate C colors and carry it to it? You know, if I remember, there was some extra behind to do synthesis.
Good question. First of all, we are already generating LVMIR, so we are not really changing that because that would be like a huge amount of work to change it to generating C.
Yeah.
We have it much more under control to generate LVMIR. So that's probably the reason. We can even, LVMIR allows you to do custom optimization and stuff like that. But yeah, the most, I think the first reason is that we have it under more under control.
Okay.
But at the time it was implemented, I think the support for like generating C into BPF was not